After watching the last video on corporations and limited liability, you might be asking yourself, was that fair? If Bill had owned the cab himself and got sued, the soccer player whose career was ruined would have gotten his actual $1 million. But because Bill set up this corporation and put the assets of the cab company in this corporation, he was able to limit his liability. The soccer player was only able to get $180,000. The corporation declared bankruptcy, but Bill's liability was limited to what he had contributed to the corporation. And you might say, my God, this guy over here, his life was somewhat ruined, and he's not able to kind of get compensated for, I guess, how bad his life was ruined. And Bill is so rich. Bill is so rich, he could probably still make money. He should give him the money. So you should say, you know, this is kind of an unfair way that these corporations are a way for well-off people or wealthy people to protect their assets. And to some degree, that's true. But I want to think about in this video is kind of the trade-offs. And really, this is just a balance that society has to pick. That this really was, on at least the way I had set it up in the last video, it was kind of unfair to the soccer player. I mean, he is only getting $180,000 for something that might have ruined his career. But if you had talked to Bill, Bill might have said, well, you know, that's right. Corporations are kind of limiting liability for someone like me. But he'd say, look, I wouldn't have started, or you know, maybe he wouldn't have started the cab company if he didn't have that limited liability. He said, look, if I had all of these assets, maybe he had $1 million. Maybe he had he does have $1 million. Maybe he had $100 million. He said, look, if I had $100 million and I didn't have the option of starting a corporation, I would not have started a cab company, because just for a little bit of small profit that I could have gotten from an $80,000 cab, I wouldn't have wanted to just jeopardize the rest of my empire. So if I didn't have limited liability, I wouldn't have started the business to begin with, and that would not have been good for society. Another argument Bill might make, and I'm not going to take sides here, I'm just saying these are the things that you have to weigh when you set up a legal code in a society, is that Bill said, look, whoever starts a cab business, this cab business that, you know, roughly you could start with $80,000, $90,000, or $100,000, they all have the same upside. They're taking a certain amount of risk. They're providing a service to the city. They'll probably make a similar amount of money. And he would argue that it would be unfair that we have different downsides. Maybe Sal right here. Maybe my only assets are the cab plus licenses, and I have $80,000 over there. And the insurance, which is $1,000. And so what Bill would say is, look, me and Sal could both open the exact same cab business. And if there were no corporations, if I had to own, and when I say I'm talking about Bill, if Bill had to own the assets of the cab company, or I shouldn't say the cab company, I should say if Bill had to directly own the assets, the cab and licenses, even though Bill's and Sal's upside from the business, the profit they could make would be the same, Bill's downside would be more, because if he didn't have the corporation, he would have all of these other assets at risk. And maybe that would make Bill get a bigger policy. Instead of a $100,000 policy, maybe he would want to get a $1 million policy. And then a $1 million policy will probably cost 10 times more. It would cost $10,000 to have that policy. And so if you view it from that way, in order to protect his other assets, his cost of business would be higher just because he happens to have other things. And so Bill might argue, hey, that wouldn't be fair. It would again be a reason why someone with assets would be less inclined to start another business, which may not be great for society. And then the other thing that Bill might argue is that, look, in exchange for limited liability, he might have to be double taxed. And this is an interesting discussion here, because you'll probably hear this term a lot, double taxation. Double taxation. It's not necessarily going to happen, but if it's a large corporation, the type of corporations that are publicly traded, this will happen. And the idea behind double taxation, it's not true for all corporations. And in fact, let me differentiate it. Double taxation happens with a C corporation, a C corp. It does not happen with things called S-corps, and I'm not going to go in detail here on what these are. S-corps, LLC, which stands for Limited Liability Corporation, LPs, which stand for Limited Partnerships, or Limited Liability Partnerships, LLPs. It doesn't apply to any of these things. But what happens in double taxation is that, let's say you have some corporation, some C corp, and let's say that it makes, let's say it makes $1,000 in profit. So it makes $1,000 in profit in a given year. That since this is being treated as kind of a legal entity that's kind of like a person by the government, it gets taxed like a person. So they're going to have to pay some tax. Maybe it's, let's say, 30% tax. So they're going to have to pay 30% or 35% or whatever the corporate tax, the marginal corporate tax rate for this corporation is going to be. So they're going to have to pay $300 in taxes. And then let's say this corporation, whatever it has left over after taxes, so this is, let me make it clear, this is pre-tax. Pre-tax profit, it pays 30% to the government, and so it has $700, and so it has $700 in net income. So this is net of taxes and everything. And let's say it then dividends that out to its shareholders. So then it gives it to its shareholders. And let's just say for simplicity, there's one shareholder. So one shareholder. But this is true even if there were more than one shareholders. So that one shareholder, he's getting $700 in income based on the fact that he owns this corporation. He is going to have to pay taxes again. So that $700, so he has to pay taxes. So let me do it this way. Let me draw it. He has to pay taxes again. Maybe his marginal tax rate is another 30%. So he'll have to pay 30% to the government again. So this is 30% on the $700. So he'll pay $210 in taxes to the government based on this net income from his dividend that he's getting out from the C corporation. And actually, I want to be very careful here. I don't want to get into the details, but dividends can sometimes be taxed differently than straight up income. But just for the sake of simplicity, let's say it's 30%. It might be a lower or higher amount. But this is the idea of double taxation. The corporation is viewed as a legal entity. It pays taxes, and then after those taxes, it's able to give its money back to shareholders, and then those shareholders have to pay money on that income again. So that's what the double taxation is. And regardless, you know, some people say, hey, this is horribly unfair. You know, why should you have to pay taxes twice on the same money? And then someone would argue, well, look, you're getting all of this limited liability. If you don't like paying those double taxes, don't set up a corporation, and then just accept the full straight-up liability. So it's a trade-off. You pay the double taxes, you get the limited liability. And let me be clear here, this applies mainly to large corporations. If you want the limited liability, but you don't want to have to do this double taxation, any of these other corporate structures are available. And these are usually available to smaller, less complicated companies, I should say, than what's going on with the C corp. And in S corp, you have a limited number of shareholders. LLCs, they can't last forever. They stop lasting as soon as one of the partners of the corporation, one of the owners of the corporation, pass away or declare bankruptcy. So there are limitations here, but these do get the benefits of limited liability, and the profits get passed through to the owners without getting taxed first. And so they also have single taxation. So going back to the fairness issue, if Bill was smart when he started this company, he probably would set this up as a limited liability corporation or as an S corporation or something where he doesn't have to get double taxed, and still he would avoid having to pay the soccer player the full $1 million, just whatever the company has, that's all the soccer player would get. But let's say the car service becomes huge and he wants to make it public one day, then he would have to make it a C corporation, and then he would have to do the whole double taxation. But it's something to think about. You know, it's an interesting to think about. Is it fair to have something like this? The pro-corporation side is it encourages entrepreneurship. People won't worry about the downside as much. It kind of levels the playing field in terms of regardless of however many side assets you have the same liability for a certain amount of business. And there's usually certain rules that you have to have a certain amount of money in the corporation, a certain amount of insurance in the corporation. If you don't, then possibly the court can go after the owner's assets, but as long as you maintain it in a responsible, well-capitalized way, it probably won't. And then the other trade-off is this double taxation thing, that at least for large corporations, the type that, you know, the General Electrics and the Googles and the Microsofts of the world, they do pay a fee for this limited liability, and that's in terms of this double taxation. Although smaller corporations, right when they're getting started out, or kind of partnerships, they don't have the double taxation, but they do get the limited liability.